introduce the first speaker, Nino Stocchetti, who is the godfather of neurointensive care from Milano. He's going to talk about complex evaluation and neurological conditions, or neurological evaluation of complex conditions. It seems difficult, and only someone with Nino's wisdom would be able to cope.
Thank you, Debbie. Good afternoon, everybody. It's funny because just 1 minute ago, the chairman asked me, what are you going to talk about? So I think that this uncertainty says exactly how complex could be the presentation. But I will try to make it simple. I have no conflict of interest to disclose. And I will go through four main points. First, we are dealing with neurological observation under difficult conditions because neurological observation matters, is essential. I would describe how frequent the confounders could be, and I will also say and try to convince you that the frequency of this confounder is getting more and more disturbing for our normal job. Finally, I will try to be pragmatic and suggest something that has to be done. Neurological observation is important. I think it's essential and is nowadays not just based on semiology. It should combine kind of an examination with imaging and possibly with sequential observation that we call monitoring. So let me ask at the very beginning three simple questions that could be the goals that we have to deal with when we start examining a patient. Is this patient awake, drunk, or comatose? Does this patient need a CP? Does this patient need an ICP? These are practical questions, but these are also practical decisions that make this moment very important. Sometimes the lives of our patient depends on the answer we give to these questions. So let me suggest you a nice website. It's easy to remember, glasgow.scale.org. And this is Grant Easel, who is not the godfather, he's really the grandfather or the father of the Glasgow Coma Scale. I think that it's very informative. If you have the passion of going through this video, he will teach you how to do it. And I take it also as a very good exercise for practicing English, because his English is so difficult that if you could understand him, that will really improve your education. So please feel free, it's free. And the same glasgow.scale.org, now I'm serious, could be really educational. Because you see that there are sections like check, observe, stimulate, rate. So whatever are the details that you are looking for, I think that in this website you can be satisfied. Unfortunately, confounders are frequent. And the first confounder is ourselves. Because more and more often we are examining patients who have been rescued from the scene, let's say of a crash accident or a home, and they have been taken care of by good doctors, so they have been intubated under sedation, often with paralysis. So the classical Glasgow Coma Scale, based on three components, where the verbal component is the second one, could not be explored if you have a tube. And all the other responses can be heavily influenced by medication. This is an old study that we performed with Giuseppe and Luigi, two friends, Giuseppe Citeri and Luigi Baretti in Milano. We were looking at patients who did too well. So the idea was, how is it possible that we have patients that in a couple of days they arrive severe and they are out of the ICU doing well? We are not that good, we were sure of it. So we separated patients who got a surgical lesion. In this patient, you may expect a sudden improvement because the hematoma has been removed. And we were looking at four, nine patients without surgical lesions. And the conclusion was that in 13% of cases, the patient have been rated wrongly by us. The reason? They were still under the effect of sedation, anesthesia, and paralysis. So even in specialized centers, it may happen that you look at the patient, you don't wake enough, and your score can be wrong. There is a second possibility, it's not us, it's not anesthesia, it's intoxication. And more frequently now, we are exposed to a combination of powerful drugs. So it's not infrequent to have patients who are positive for cannabis, opioids, and unknown substances. So let's go back to the very old intoxication, which is alcohol. This is a paper in the Journal of Neurosurgery looking at patients with moderate or severe TBI who have been checked for alcohol. I don't know if there are Norwegians here in the room, because that is has been really data collected in Norwegian country, and you see 43% of the patients, so almost half of the patients were drunk at the moment of being admitted, which is not typical only of Scandinavia. It may well happen everywhere. So you see 217 patients, half of them more or less alcohol positive. What is the influence of alcohol on neurological inflammation? Let me remind you the Rotterdam Coma Scale, because this is the tool that the authors have used in their paper. The Rotterdam Coma CT scan score is a way of checking for important imaging features that are relevant to explain severity. So let's say, if the systems were normal, compressed, or absent, then you sum up and you have an increasing score. So the idea is, the higher the Rotterdam score, the worse the CT. And that is important, because if you look at patients who were relatively under benign conditions, meaning the CT was not that bad, or it was almost normal, you see that alcohol decreased the Glasgow DCS score. So the more alcohol was sampled into the plasma, the worse were the neurological responses if the intracranial lesions were not overwhelming. On the contrary, if the Rotterdam score was high, meaning that there were hematomas, swelling, compression, edema, many things, then the influence of alcohol, you have here the increasing alcohol level into the plasma, were not that determinant. I think that makes sense. And these are important data because if you check, there was a decrease of several GCS points. There is another paper in Journal of Neurotrauma, which I think is a little bit imprecise, because it says alcohol intoxication doesn't reduce the GCS more than 1 point. In Norwegian, in Norway, it decreased 4 points. So it's questionable. But the message is clear. If you have a drunk patient, please check the patient carefully. Don't lose time waiting for sober up. And that is my personal reflection of the issue of intoxication. If you have experience with the ER, you know that alcohol causes a lot of things. Usually the patients are unpleasantly smelling, they have unsocial behavior, and they vomit very often. But alcohol cannot explain anisocoria or unilateral posturing. So please be very, very careful. Even if the patient is not a nice one, check him and distinguish what can be attributed to intoxication compared to what has to do with a different cause. So what about other possible confounders? In a paper published in Lancet Neurology 2014, again, Grant Teasdale was listing all possible factors influences the GCS assessment, like in this case, existing disorders. If the patient is demented, how can be the verbal response or the orientation of the patient? The last issue, language barrier. It happens more frequently, I think, in all European countries to have people who are admitted to ER and they don't speak any intelligible language. So the contact becomes difficult. What about, of course, orbital injuries or intubation and tracheostomy? And finally, if there are lesions at the arms, so how can we assess flexion extension if they can't move or there is a spinal cord injury? In conclusion, I think that the motor score remains the main focus of this investigation. We can't do the verbal in intubated patients. We can't explore the eye opening in partial injury, but we have to be aware that this apparently simple score requires a lot of attention. This is becoming an increasingly disturbing factor. And this is a paper by, at the time, a fellow in Cambridge, Balestrelli the name, and she was looking with the Marek Czosnicka group at the changing correlation between, you see here, the GCS and the GOS. Marcella was looking at patient, and she was looking at the initial score, and then she was looking at the 6 months outcome of this patient, and they expressed that as a correlation, and the correlation was lost. What was happening? I would like to show you data that have been published later on, and you see here, this is the Glasgow Coma Scale score. You know that the UK, even before Brexit, they behave differently. So for the rest of Europe, the GCS maximum is 15. For the UK, it could be 14. But anyway, 14 down to 3. And if you look here at the odds of that, you see that apparently to extend seems much worse than having no motor response, which is a challenge for biology. Because if the brainstem is so damaged that you don't have any response, that should be much worse than at least extending. And these data have been also retrieved in other series, and you see here, extension looks much worse than doing nothing. I think that this is an important point. My interpretation is, if you have extension, the patient remains testable. So you do something, you apply the painful stimulants, and the patient does. If you don't have any response, you have two possibilities. One, the patient is really very, very bad. The second, the patient is still under the influence of anesthesia and or paralysis. What should we do? The message has to be very clear and simple. I suggest you this reading is 2014, Tarek Shakar and the group in the European Society of Intensive Care Medicine. Is very practical, and what they say is the neurological examination should include something like the Glasgow plus brain stem. So pupils or other response should be checked. And of course, that requires that we may be able to examine the patient. So you see here, you have to discontinue sedation. In the occurrence of a patient with raised intracranial pressure, that may raise concern. That is a typical trace that you may have in a patient who starts not very badly, then we stop sedation, and here we have been forced to cover it back. And Raymond Helbock, who is sitting here in the first line, published this interesting paper. He was saying that if you apply properly in 20 cases, this opening of the window, so you discontinue sedation and you do something, then the patient may respond, and they say they are not happy, the respiratory rate, the heart rate, the arterial pressure go up, and XCP may be up as well. And others have confirmed this finding, even if, again, from Scandinavia, looking at other parameters, it looks like the window could be tolerated. So in conclusion, I think that we have the duty of examining the patient. It may seem a simple task, it is not, and it's impacting our practice, so we better be capable of doing it. Then it remains the issue. By applying a stimulus to the patient, we are disturbing the patient. So the final suggestion is, of course, we are asking the patient to pay a price. Therefore, when we decide to perform a neurological evaluation, that has to be because this evaluation is necessary. So if we have a question, we better answer. If we don't have a question, why we have to bother our patients? Thank you for your attention.